Tragedy and Hope, A History of the World in Our Time, by Carroll Quigley. Chapter 18. The Near East. The oil crisis in Iran was limited in scope and duration. Neither of these can be said of the great and continuing crisis experienced by the Arabic Near East in the 20th century. The crisis of these countries was a crisis of the system itself. The collapse of Islamic civilization, culminating in the disappearance of the Ottoman Empire, which ruled over it in its later stages. The Near East today is the wreckage of that civilization, and as such presents problems far greater than the simple one of inadequate natural resources. Rather, the problem is a triple one: of resources, of creating a workable and viable social organization, and of developing patterns of belief, outlook, and feelings which have some constructive value for human survival. In this colossal problem, the influence of the Soviet Union, or of the Western powers, or even of the Cold War conflict itself, are relatively minor matters which could be reduced to much less significance if the peoples of the area could get themselves organized, both externally and internally, into some viable arrangement of living patterns. The same problem is being faced throughout the broad band of countries from Indonesia and Japan, across China and India, throughout Africa to Latin America. But almost nowhere is the problem more acute and apparently more hopeless than in the Near East. This arises from the area's strategic importance between Asia, Africa, and Europe, its nearness to the Soviet Union, its central position in the air routes and the water communications of the world, symbolized by the Suez Canal, and its great significance in the world's petroleum supplies. The broadest aspects of the Near East's problems must be reserved to a later discussion dealing with the general problems of the buffer fringe and the underdeveloped areas. At the moment, we must concentrate on the two most acute and immediate problems of the area. These are Israel and Egypt. These two problems are working within a background of five significant factors. First is the continuing Soviet-American rivalry, which benefits no one in the Near East. Second is the sordid and grinding poverty of Near Eastern life, a poverty made up in almost equal parts of poor natural resources, especially water shortages, wasteful and irrational social organization, and hopelessly uncooperative and spiteful personality patterns. Third is the shifting but perpetual dynastic and political rivalries of the area among the Arab countries themselves. Fourth is the almost incredibly misdirected interferences from the Western powers, especially the United States. And fifth is the dominant role played by the armed forces in Near Eastern life. Of these five background factors, only the last requires any amplification here. Wherever a modern state structure appears in an impoverished environment, the possession of arms is restricted to a small group and tends to bring control of the whole society under the influence of those who possess the arms. This problem becomes particularly acute in areas where other countervailing factors, such as religion, family influence, or traditional organizations, are weak, and where the social values of the society place a high esteem on military prowess or violence. The Arabs had always been warlike. By adopting Islam in the 7th century, they acquired a religion which intensified this tendency. This was clearly shown in the Saracen conquests of the Near East, North Africa, and southwestern Europe within a century of Muhammad's death. Certain restraints, however, were placed upon the militarism by other factors, such as the religious elements in Islam and the powerful influence of family and tribal loyalties. By the 20th century, the steady dwindling of these alternative influences, and finally the total disintegration of Islamic society, left militarism in a much more dominant position. This situation is evident wherever Arabic influence spread, including North Africa, Spain, and Latin America, so that today the army is the chief political force all the way from the Persian Gulf to Peru. We have already seen the chief example of this in Spain. The situation is roughly the same throughout the Arabic Near East. This dominance by the armed forces would not be so objectionable were it not that their leaders are 1. Ignorant, 2. Selfish, 3. Outstanding obstacles to any progressive reorganization of the community, especially by their diversion of the limited wealth available for social or economic investment, and 4. Are so lacking in military morale or competence that they provide almost no protection for the areas which they are presumably supposed to defend. Certainly, any area needs some organized force of arms-bearing persons to maintain public order and to protect the area from external interference. But the incompetence of the existing armed forces from Kuwait to Bolivia is so great that a superior degree of public order and defense could have been achieved with a greater degree of stability from a simple gendarmerie equipped with motor cars and handguns than from the expensive arrays of complicated and misused equipment which have been provided for or forced upon the armies of this great area from the United States, the Western European powers, or since 1955, the Communist bloc. Although paramilitary regimes, in imitation of Britain and France, had been established throughout the Near East, as in much of the world, they never functioned as democratic or even constitutional systems because of the lack of organized political parties and of any traditions of civil and personal rights. Political parties remained largely personal followings or blocs, and political power based on the arbitrary autocracy of Semitic patriarchal family life was also personal and never took on the impersonal characteristics associated with Western rule of law and constitutional practices. The weakness of any conception of rules and of the material benefits which help rules to survive made it impossible for the Near East to grasp the conventions associated with cooperation in opposition found in the Western two-party system, parliamentary practices, and sports. The whole range of human and universal relations of the Arabs was monastic, personal, and extra-legal, in contrast to that of the West, which was pluralistic, impersonal, and subject to rules. As a result, constitutional and two-party politics were incomprehensible to the Near East, and the parliamentary system, where it existed, was only a facade for an autocratic system of personal intrigues. It is no accident that two-party politics functioned in the Near East only briefly and in two non-Arabic, if Muslim, countries, Turkey and the Sudan. It is almost no accident that in most of the Near East, the chief method for changing a government was by assassination, and that such actions usually took place in the most cowardly fashion, to Western eyes, such as shooting in the back. The growth of militarism in the Near East modified these political practices to some extent, but without changing them in any fundamental way. The parliament was ignored or abolished. Political groups and blocs were eliminated or outlawed, often being replaced by a single, amorphous and meaningless party, whose sole purpose was propaganda, and military administration generally replaced civil parliamentary government. Most obviously, perhaps, Changes of regime now take place by military coups, instead of by rigged elections or by assassinations. Even the Sudan and Turkey had their two-party parliamentary regimes overturned by military coup d'etat in 1958 and in 1960. Elsewhere, factions within the officers' corps have replaced parliamentary political parties as the significant units of political conflict. Thus, Iraq had military coups in 1936, 1941, 1958, and 1963. Similar events were frequent in Syria, notably in 1949, 1951, 1961, and 1962. That the poverty, chaos, and disunity of the Arab world was a consequence of organizational and moral factors, rather than of such objective obstacles as limited natural resources, is clear from the case of Israel. There, in less than 8,000 square miles, with no significant resources and hampered by endless external obstacles, the Zionist movement has constructed the strongest, most stable, most progressive, most democratic, and most hopeful state in the Near East. This was possible because of the morale of the Israeli, which was based on outlooks antithetical to the attitudes of the Arabs. The Israeli were full of self-sacrifice, self-discipline, social solidarity, readiness to work, cooperation, and hopes for the future. Their ideology was largely Western, with a devotion to science, democracy, individual respect, technology, and the future which could match or exceed the best periods of the Western past. All these things made them anathema to the Arabs, whose hysterical hatred was not really aimed at the loss of Palestine as a land, but at the presence of the Israeli, whose qualities were a refutation of generations of Arab self-deceptions and pretenses. The precarious balance the British had tried to keep in Palestine between their promises to the Zionists and their efforts to placate the Arabs were destroyed by Hitler's determination to annihilate the Jews of Europe and the conditions of World War II, which made it seem that he would be successful. The Jews, their supporters and allies, tried to smuggle in any Jews who could be saved from Europe. Since there was nowhere else they could go, many were smuggled into Palestine. British efforts to prevent this, in fulfillment of their obligations to the Arabs under the League of Nations mandate, led to a kind of guerrilla warfare between Jews and British, with the Arabs attacking the former intermittently. This problem reached acute form when the conquest of Germany opened the doors for surviving Jews to escape from the horrors of Nazism. In August 1945, President Truman asked British permission to admit 100,000 European Jews into Palestine, but his repeated requests were refused. Ignoring such permission, large-scale efforts were made to smuggle Jewish refugees into Palestine, where they could be cared for by Jewish groups. Many of these were transported under frightful conditions in overcrowded, leaky ships, which were often intercepted by the British, who took their passengers to concentration camps in Cyprus. From such actions came reprisals and counter-reprisals. The Zionist settlement in Palestine was largely agricultural, the immigrants being settled in close-knit village communities on lands, often semi-arid lands, purchased by funds raised by the World Zionist Conference or its friends and administered under the Jewish Agency for Palestine. These organizations gave the Zionist groups, over several decades, the political and administrative experience and the patterns of self-sacrifice for a common cause, which provided the functioning political structure of the State of Israel as the British mandate for Palestine was ended in 1948. The Zionist communal villages, under constant danger of attack by Arab raiders, developed a mentality somewhat like that of early American frontier settlements, amid hostile Indians. Each village developed a force of trained defense fighters, its Haganah, with arms hidden in the village or in a regional center, for the day in which they must fight for their continued existence. This Haganah organization subsequently became the Army of Israel. British raids on Zionist centers to arrest illegal immigrants or to seize hidden arms, and Arab attacks upon incautious Zionist settlements, soon led to reprisals and counter-reprisals, and to the creation of violent and bitter splinter groups within the Zionist effort. The Jewish Agency did not have absolute control over the Haganah, and had decreasingly less over a number of minute reprisal groups, of which the chief were the extremist Irgun Zvi Lumi, with several thousand members, or the terrorist Stern Gang, of less than 200. The latter group had murdered the British High Commissioner, Lord Moyne, in November 1944, and later assassinated the United Nations mediator, Count Folke Bernadotte, of Sweden, in September 1948. During the years 1945 to 1948, the Jewish Agency sought to establish a Jewish state in Palestine, to remove the rigid British restrictions on Jewish immigration and Jewish land purchases, and to obtain an international loan to finance its Jewish settlement policies. These were resisted not only because of Britain's desire to remain on amicable relations with the Arab states, but also from the obvious lack of sympathy for the Zionist cause within the British government, especially after Churchill's national government was replaced by a Labour Party regime in 1945. The immediate demand for admission of 100,000 Jewish refugees from Europe was rejected by the British, and efforts to smuggle some of these in gave rise to conditions of quasi-warfare between Britain and the Zionist groups. A League of the Neighboring Arab States, which had been formed under British sponsorship in March 1945, took as its chief aim the destruction of the Zionist plans, and sought to block Jewish immigration or use up Haganah arms by sneak raids on Zionist frontier settlements. When the Labor government in June 1946 refused the Zionist request for admission of the 100,000 refugees, and instead sought to arrest the members of the Jewish Agency, the Irgun Zvi Lumi, in reprisal, exploded 500 pounds of TNT under the British headquarters in the east wing of the luxurious King David Hotel in Jerusalem, killing almost 100 persons. The World Zionist Congress election of December showed decreasing support for more moderate figures like Dr. Shyam Weizmann and David Ben-Gurion. The former won re-election as president of the World Zionist Movement by a bare majority and refused to offer his name for re-election as president of the Jewish Agency. This increase in the extremist influence within the Zionist movement made it clear to Britain that peace in Palestine could be maintained only at a great cost, which the Labour government was unable and unwilling to pay. Support for the mandate from the United States was unobtainable, since Washington generally tended to favor the Jewish side, while the British, in spite of their valiant efforts to appear impartial, clearly favored the Arabs. Death sentences on Jewish terrorists, first carried out by the British in 1947, merely intensified the violence, with the British armed forces suffering about 3 casualties a week, one-third fatal. In April 1947, the British sought to escape from the situation by appealing to the United Nations, which voted in November to partition Palestine into 2 intertwining Jewish and Arab zones, with an international zone in Jerusalem. The Arab League rejected partition, and its members swore to resist it by force, by a relentless war, according to a Cairo newspaper. This war opened with Arab riots in Palestine against the UN vote at the very time that the Jews were welcoming it. Arab irregulars began to enter Palestine from Syria and Egypt as the British began to withdraw from their long effort to administer the country. This British withdrawal from Palestine was but one aspect of the general withdrawal of Britain from its pre-war world and imperial position. It was a consequence of the general political weakening of Great Britain. Its acute economic and financial position in the post-war period, and, above all, by the growing preference of the ordinary British voter for social welfare and higher living standards at home over the remote and impersonal glories of imperial prestige abroad. On September 26, 1947, the British announced they would withdraw from Palestine, and that failure to obtain a United Nations administration or any accepted Arab Zionist partition would not delay this process. However, the British were determined not to hand over the administration to the only organization available which was capable of handling the job, the Jewish Agency, and as a result simply abandoned or closed down many public services and destroyed or left many essential administrative records. This created a chaotic situation in which the Arab League was unable to rule. The United Nations and Britain were unwilling to rule, and the Jewish Agency was prevented from taking over by the retiring British forces. At the beginning of April 1948, small forces from Syria, Iraq, and Egypt entered Palestine to support the local Arabs' efforts to prevent the Jewish Agency taking control of the country. They were followed by the Arab Legion of Transjordan under British officers, which came in as soon as the British mandate ended on May 14, 1948. Although the Zionists were outnumbered and had inferior equipment, their courage, tenacity, and persistence was combined with the mutual rivalries and divisions among the five Arab groups, allowed the Israeli to establish and consolidate a Zionist government in several areas of Palestine. During the interval, financial support from American sympathizers allowed the Zionists to rectify the arms disequilibrium, chiefly by purchases from Czechoslovakia, which had just joined the Iron Curtain bloc in March. As early as January, many Arab families had begun to flee from Palestine, and by June this became a flood. Many left voluntarily, encouraged by the unrealistic promises of the Arab League to return them as conquerors after the total defeat of Zionism. But a substantial number were uprooted and expelled by Zionist retaliatory actions. Eventually, in spite of the Jewish Agency's promise that Arabs would be welcome to continue to live in Israel if they did not act to subvert the new state, the number of refugees reached an estimated 652,000 persons. Most of these were settled in camps along the frontiers in Jordan and in Egypt, and were maintained by international charity administered under the United Nations. Efforts to resettle these unfortunates within the Arab states of the Near East were blocked by these states, which refused to cooperate in any such recognition of the changed situation in Palestine, and which welcomed refugee discontent as an instrument for stirring up hatred of Israel and the West among their own citizens. Large numbers of the refugees eventually left these camps and integrated themselves by their own efforts into the life of the Arab states of the Near East. But birth rates in the camps were so high that the total number in the camps decreased very slowly. In Jordan, the refugees who became assimilated were so numerous and so bitter that they came to dominate that precarious state, were a constant threat to the stability of its government, forced it to destroy its friendly relations with Britain, which had founded it, and remained as an explosive threat against Israel. The new state of Israel was proclaimed by Ben-Gurion on May 14, 1948, and was recognized by President Truman 16 minutes later, in a race to beat the Soviet Union, whose recognition came May 17th. efforts by both to use the United Nations machinery to stop the Israeli-Arab war in Palestine was frustrated by conflicting opinions, and especially by British efforts to restrict Israeli acquisition of arms and immigration without placing comparable restrictions on the surrounding Arab states. A truce imposed by the UN on June 11th was violated by both sides and broke down with a resumption of fighting in July. But by that time, the Arab states were squabbling bitterly among themselves and were increasingly involved in embarrassment because their propaganda falsehoods to their own peoples about their glorious victories over Zionism could not be sustained in the face of the precipitous retreats of their forces under Israeli attacks. Some of the Arab states tried to excuse their defeats as resulting from Transjordanian treason. 10 days of renewed fighting from July 8th to the 18th, 1948, mostly favorable to Israel, were ended by a 3-day UN ultimatum threatening sanctions against any state which continued fighting. This curtailment of Israeli success by United Nations actions and the UN mediator's suggestion that Jerusalem be given to the Arabs led directly to his assassination by Israeli extremists in September. On September 20th, the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem, chief Muslim religious leader of the Levant, and a wartime collaborator with the Nazis, proclaimed an Arab government of all Palestine, which was at once recognized by all the Arab states except Jordan, and was set up at Gaza on Palestine territory occupied by Egypt. Israel, in return, launched successful and successive week-long attacks on Egypt and Lebanon, which were stopped by UN truces on October 31, 1948. Belated recognition of the truth about Egypt's weakness, if not its corruption, led to street riots in Cairo and assassination of the Egyptian Prime Minister. British efforts to invoke its 1936 alliance with Egypt to justify British military action against Israel were blocked by Egypt's refusal to allow such a public display of Egypt's helplessness. 5 British planes, which attacked Israel, were promptly shot down, January 7, 1949. This led to Britain's de facto recognition of Israel on January 29th, and the gradual release of Jewish immigrants imprisoned on Cyprus. A series of armistice agreements were negotiated in the spring of 1949. These left various forces in approximately the positions they held, but were accompanied by explicit refusals by the Arab states to make peace with Israel, to recognize its existence, or to allow any steps to be taken to remedy the plight of Arab refugees outside Palestine. To this day, these problems remain, with the Arab states still at war with Israel and publicly sworn to exterminate it. Egypt's defeat in the Israeli war brought to a head persistent Egyptian discontent, especially its hatred for the corrupt and lecherous King Farouk. Egypt's plight, however, was far deeper and more ancient than Israel and Farouk's blame, in spite of his total failure as a ruler, was less than that of his great-grandfather, Muhammad Ali, who had been Khedive of Egypt under the Ottoman Sultan in 1811 to 1848. Until Muhammad Ali's time, Egypt continued its ancient practice of raising a single crop of food from each annual flooding of the Nile Valley. Muhammad Ali, in order to finance his plans to conquer the whole Near East, took over state ownership of all the land and built a great network of irrigation canals, which permitted perennial cultivation of the land, with 2 to 4 crops a year. He also established state monopolies of industrial enterprises to equip his armed forces. Muhammad Ali's successors, especially his grandson, Ismail, ended state ownership of land and industry, allowing both to fall into private hands, where they retained much of their monopolistic character. At the same time, they burdened the country with enormous debts to European bankers for public works projects of irrigation, railroads, and the Suez Canal. In the same period, the demand for Egyptian long-lint cotton became so great during the world cotton shortage caused by the American Civil War that it became the favorite crop of the landlord class and the chief source of foreign exchange to pay off Egypt's debts. But this meant that Egypt's prosperity became linked to the uncontrolled fluctuations of prices on the Liverpool cotton market. The results of all this were to create the Egypt of 1936, the first year of Farouk's reign. Irrigation, with its perpetual motion farming, greatly increased the output of food and allowed an increase in population from 3.2 million in 1821 to 6.8 million in 1892 to 12.5 million in 1914. At the same time, European science, by its control of epidemic diseases, reduced the infant mortality rate. The rise in population began to outstrip the increase in food supply by a wide margin, especially when the small group of large landowners insisted that the land be used for exported cotton rather than for home-consumed food. In 1914, production of cereals was 3.5 million tons for 12.5 million Egyptians. By 1940, there was only 4 million tons for 17 million persons. The output of food continued to crawl upward following the great leaps in population. By 1960, the population was increasing at the rate of one person a minute, over 500,000 a year, and had already passed 26 million. Moreover, as a result of perennial irrigation, the population of 1940 was much less healthy than that of 1840, since it was infected with debilitating, chronic waterborne infectious diseases like malaria, bilharzia, encyclostomiasis, and irritating eye infections. Moreover, unlike the ancient cultivation based on annual flooding, which replaced the fertility of the soil, the perennial irrigation of today requires artificial fertilizers, which the harassed peasant cannot afford, to retain the productivity of the soil. Thus, by 1950, an enormously increased population, wore down by anemia and malnutrition, was crowded in a narrow valley under the greatest population density in the world, with neither land nor work for idle millions. Their miserable fates entirely in the hands of the small ruling elite of landlords, commercial monopolists, and political exploiters of world economic changes. Until 1952, monopolization of land, although less complete than in other Near Eastern countries, was nevertheless extreme, since 3% of the landowners held 55% of the agricultural land, and 28% of the owners held 87% of the land. The remaining 72% of landowners, with 13% of the land, were too poor to exploit their plots effectively, since they could not afford fertilizer, choice seed, or adequate tools, and in most cases had to supplement their work on the land by other activities or by renting plots from other owners. Since the great owners did not work their lands themselves, most Egyptian soil was worked by renters and sharecroppers, often removed from the real owner by a series of intermediaries and subleasers. In addition, of course, millions without land of their own had to work for about 5 American cents an hour on the lands of others, and a third group eked out an existence entirely from rented land, in which the rents were equal to about 3/4 of the net yield. The burden of population on the land, about 1,500 persons per square mile compared to about 200 in France, left everyone drastically underemployed, with at least half the rural population merely sitting around in the dust or napping all day. because children were more healthy than their diseased, sapped parents. They were more energetic and often were skillful and could be obtained for wages less than half that of men, about 20 American cents for a day of 10 or 12 hours in 1956. Much of the agricultural work, especially in cotton, was done by children. The pressure of population, the productivity of the land from multiple cropping, average annual yields about twice those in Europe, and monopolized land ownership drove land prices and rents upward, just as they drove wages downward. This gave rise to a steady increase of renting and sharecropping before 1952. By 1948, the cash rental of land per acre was about 30% higher than the average net income per acre. Thus, the situation in the rural economy was explosive. These problems reached this critical level under the shield of the artificial prosperity of Egypt during the war. As the chief base for the Allied war effort in the Near East and the center of the British resistance to Rommel's Africa Corps, Allied supplies and money had poured into Egypt and provided wages and a higher standard of living for all. Moreover, high wartime prices for cotton had created a temporary boom. By 1947, all this collapsed, and hundreds of thousands who had been supported by British spending during the war were wandering the alleys of Cairo without money, work, or hope. In sharp contrast with the poverty of millions, about 400 families had made immense fortunes from the land since 1850. In 1952, when 250 acres brought its owner an income of about $20,000 a year, the royal family had close to 200,000 acres, and the few hundred landlord families held over 1 million acres. Little of these incomes was devoted to any constructive purpose, although few of their possessors lived such dissolute and wasteful existences as Farouk. These economic discontents were capped by political unrest. Egypt had been granted its independence by Great Britain in 1922, but the latter continued to interfere in the governing of the country by peremptory notes, or even ultimatums, as in 1924 and 1938. Submission by the monarchy or the government to such pressure roused great animosity in the assembly, which was generally dominated by the irresponsible nationalist party, the Waft, led successively by Saad Sagulah and Mustafa Naash. Relations with Britain were finally regulated by a treaty in 1936, which established a 20-year alliance, granted Britain continued possession of the naval base at Alexandria until 1944, and allowed it to keep a force of 10,000 men in the Canal Zone. Other British forces were withdrawn, and the disputed question of conflicting British and Egyptian rights in the Sudan were compromised to allow limited Egyptian migration and limited use of Egyptian troops in that area. The most significant result of the Anglo-Egyptian Treaty of 1936 was a double one. By providing for withdrawal of British troops from Egypt proper, it made it necessary for Egypt to establish its own army. At the same time, it established two political issues: British troops in the Suez Canal Zone and incomplete Egyptian control of the Sudan, on which that new army could agitate. Most significant of all, Mustafa Naha's decree of 1936 establishing the military academy to train officers for the new army opened this career to any Egyptian, independent of class or economic status. This created the opening by which ambitious and relatively poor young men could work their way upward in power and wealth. It was the first essential step toward the Nasser government of the 1960s, and for the first time in thousands of years, made it possible for Egypt to be ruled by Egyptians. The Muhammad Ali dynasty of 1811 to 1952 was of Albanian origin. the first class of that military academy to graduate after the Treaty of 1936 was the class of 1938, whose members, led by Nasir, made the revolution of 1952. Most of the leaders of that revolt were either the sons or grandsons of poor peasants. The chief aims of their revolt were agrarian reform, elimination of waste, inefficiency, and corruption from the Egyptian government, and the completion of independence by the withdrawal of British influence from the Canal Zone, and, if possible, the Sudan. The revolt moved forward under the impetus of increasing shame and hatred for the Farouk monarchy. In this process, two chief steps were the British ultimatum of 1942 and the defeat by Israel in 1948, since these opened an unabridgeable gap between the dynasty and the officers' group. The conspiracies of the class of 1938 began almost immediately upon their graduation from the military academy, when Gamal Abdel Nasser joined a group which exchanged secret oaths to reform Egypt by expelling the British. By 1939, most of this group were in contact with the Muslim Brotherhood, a secret band of fanatics founded in 1929 to establish, by assassination and violence if necessary, a political regime founded on purely Muslim principles. Many of both groups were involved in the anti-British and pro-Nazi agitations throughout the Near East of 1938 to 1942. These centered around the fanatical Mufti of Jerusalem and culminated in the pro-Nazi revolt of Rashid Ali al-Kilani in Iraq during Hitler's conquest of Crete in April 1941. Britain used force to overthrow the new pro-Hitler government in Iraq, but the anti-British agitations continued throughout the Arab world. When they became acute in Egypt in February 1942, the British ambassador, accompanied by British tanks, visited King Farouk in the Abdin Palace and gave him a choice between cooperation with Britain or deposition. The king yielded at once, but many of the younger officers were outraged at this affront to Egyptian dignity, and Lieutenant Colonel Mohammed Naguib resigned his commission in protest at an army which was unable to protect its king. 10 years later, when Farouk's disgraceful behavior had alienated most of the army and disquieted much of the world, this same Naguib, by then a heroic general who had been wounded 3 times in the war of 1948 with Israel, was the nominal head of the revolt. This revolt was engineered by a small group of 5 officers, whose real leader was Nasir, although the latter, who had been conspiring against one thing or another since his school days, was virtually unknown to the police until the revolt had already started. Like most revolts, that of 1952 started from an event which had little to do with the conspirators' plans. In October 1951, Mustafa Nahas, who signed the Anglo-Egyptian Treaty of 1936, enacted a law to abrogate it. Shortly afterward, guerrilla attacks on the British military installations in the Canal Zone drove the British forces to seek to disarm the Egyptian police nearby. In the resulting fight, about 50 Egyptians were killed and 100 wounded. The next day, January 26, 1952, riots in Cairo burned down about 400 buildings, including the famous Shepherd's Hotel, the center of British tourist life in Egypt. Damage ran to over $60 million, but the real destruction was to the Egyptian political system. Police and army both refused to fire upon the incendiaries of January 26th. Farouk, who had no wish to alienate the British, dismissed Prime Minister Nahas for the cabinet's inadequate efforts to suppress the disturbances. But no successor could be found capable of winning the confidence of the diverse groups who sought to exploit the miseries of Egypt. On the night of July 22nd, 8 young officers seized control of the army headquarters. the radio stations, and the government, and forced Farouk to make General Naguib head of the army. Only 2 soldiers were killed in the process. 4 days later, with tanks surrounding the palace, Farouk was forced to abdicate and was sent into exile. The new revolution had neither doctrine nor program, and continued to improvise year after year. A civilian prime minister was replaced by General Naguib on September 7th, and he was replaced by Nasir on February 25th, 1954. Most decrees, with the exception of the Agrarian Law of 1952 and its subsequent revisions, were concerned with the officers' junta's efforts to consolidate itself in power. Opposition groups from all parts of the political spectrum were arrested, usually imprisoned without trial, and sometimes tortured. Some were tried and executed. All political parties were dissolved and their assets confiscated for the people. A rather vague pro-junta party, called the National Liberation Rally, was established to support the new regime, but without any real program. The communists, the Muslim Brotherhood, and striking labor unions were persecuted, and most of the wealthy elite were cut down in wealth and influence. The source of these authoritarian moves was Nasir. Even in the period when Naguib was both President of the Republic, June 1953 to November 1954, and Prime Minister, September 1952 to February 1954. Nasir, who replaced Naguib as Prime Minister in February 1954, replaced him as President as well in November of that year. The general issue on which they broke was Nasir's autocracy, but the specific issue was his outlawing of the Muslim Brotherhood. Nasir won out in the struggle because he was concerned only with the reality of power and was prepared to cooperate with any group, to adopt any program, or to sacrifice any friend if doing so would strengthen his control of Egypt. Originally, his personal sympathies were with the peasant masses and with the West, and there is no evidence that he was possessed of the pleasure-loving, indolent characteristics which weakened so many ambitious Arabs. He continued to regard himself as a man of the people, but his insatiable thirst was for personal power. The Agrarian Law of September 1952 determined much of the subsequent political and economic policy of the regime. It sought to alleviate the plight of the peasant and to force the landlord group, the center of Egyptian wealth, to shift their holdings from land to investment in industry and commerce. This was expected to create jobs for the numerous unemployed of the cities and to increase the Egyptian sector in trade, which was still largely in foreign hands. The original law set a maximum of land ownership of 315 acres for each family, with 210 for the head of the family, and a quarter as much for each of the first 2 children. Land beyond this amount had to be sold to the peasants who were actually working it, at a price 70 times the annual land tax, in plots of 2 to 5 acres. If not sold thus in 6 weeks, the surplus was taken by the state in return for 30-year 3% bonds, and was then sold to the peasants on long-term payments by the state. Since the peasants' cultivation, whether as laborer, renter, or sharecropper, had previously been strictly regulated by the owner, this regulatory function was, under the new law, taken over by cooperative societies, which were made compulsory in each district. These societies also act as purchasing, marketing, and training cooperatives. The law also enacted a reduction in rents for peasants who rented land. Several years later, the maximum limit for land ownership was reduced to 52.5 acres per person. The agrarian reform undoubtedly helped the peasants who obtained ownership of plots or those whose rents were reduced, but it did nothing about the landless laborers or the growing mass of persons with no economic role, who were multiplying so rapidly from the population explosion. The older landlord class, even on a 50-acre maximum, was adequately provided for, but the method of compensation for their confiscated lands did not give them the free capital which it had been hoped would expand industry and trade. Moreover, few had sufficient confidence in the economic future of Egypt or the regime itself to put much of their current incomes into such activities, especially as the Nasser government took over many of the largest and most prosperous industrial enterprises. As a result, the government itself had increasingly to create new enterprises from government funds, and the system, although committed to a mixed economy, increasingly had to move toward socialism. It was clear from the beginning that the only remedy for the population explosion was additional land, and it was equally clear that this could be achieved only if the waters of the Nile were spread widely and, more effectively, over the uncultivated periphery of the Nile Valley. For this purpose, the Nasser government proposed a high dam 3 miles south of Aswan between the first cataract of the Nile and the Sudan frontier. The project was technically feasible, but enormously expensive, and involved complex political problems. The proposed dam, 3 miles long and 120 yards high, would back up a reservoir of about 130 billion cubic meters of water, much of it in Sudan territory, and displacing 60,000 inhabitants, as well as submerging many archaeological treasures. The project, originally estimated to cost over $1 billion, would increase Egypt's farmlands by about 30%, or 2 million acres, and, by equalizing the flow of the Nile throughout the year, would steady the country's whole system of agricultural production. If the flow of water from the reservoir were harnessed to generate electricity, it could yield 10 million kilowatt hours, but this would drive the total cost up to about $4 billion over 15 years. Such a project could not possibly be financed by Egypt itself, and could not be built without previous agreement with the Sudan. Such an agreement must modify an earlier compromise of 1929, which gave Egypt 48,000 million cubic meters of water, and the Sudan only 4,000 million cubic meters out of the total Nile flow of 84,000 million cubic meters, leaving 32,000 million cubic meters which previously flowed to the sea to be divided from the new high dam reservoir. From the beginning, it should have been clear to Nasser that his regime would be a success only if he found a solution to Egypt's economic plight, and that the most substantial contribution to such a solution would come from the high dam. Such a dam could be built only with the financial assistance of the West, since the Soviet bloc lacked the free resources or the psychological outlook to do the job, and a dam of that size, 17 times the mass of the pyramid of Cheops, could not be built by Egypt's own resources soon enough to alleviate Egypt's economy. If Nasser had concentrated on this problem and determined to retain relations with the United States sufficiently amiable to obtain the necessary American aid, some progressive solution of the problems of Egypt and the Near East might have been possible. However, Nasser allowed himself to be distracted by all kinds of emotional upheavals of an unconstructive kind. He maintained a constant state of hatred and tension toward Israel. He insisted on heavy armaments Egypt neither needed nor could afford, and which Egyptians lacked the skill and the morale to use. He kept Egyptians and the whole Arab world in an uproar by his incendiary speeches and actions, and his continual political intrigues and interventions in a fantastic and needless effort to make himself the leader of Arab political movements all the way from Morocco to Lake Chad, to the Persian Gulf and Alexandretta. And he insisted on demonstrating his independence of the West by constant attacks and insults directed at the United States. The United States, in the Dulles era, contributed to this confusion by its mistaken idea that the Soviet Union was actively engaging in efforts to take over the Near East, and by Dulles's efforts to force all the countries of the area into a single defensive pact, like the Baghdad Pact. Dulles's contribution to the confusion of the Near East, as elsewhere, was that he refused to see that the problems of primary concern to the local peoples were local problems, and that these were merely worsened by his insistence that the only problem in any area was the Cold War between the West and the Soviet Union. When the United States rejected Nasser's tentative requests for heavy weapons, Nasser went to the Soviet bloc with his demands and obtained a large part of his requests, far beyond his real needs, but on a barter arrangement which tied up the Egyptian cotton crop for years in the future and removed this major prop of Egypt's economy out of the economic picture. Without cotton to sell for foreign exchange, Nasser could not hope to ameliorate Egypt's immediate economic problems. At the same time, while filling the air with denunciations of the United States and threats to Israel, Nasser opened his discussions for the financial assistance necessary to construct the High Dam. When the International Bank, as well as the American government, agreed to contribute to the project, in principle, but insisted on certain necessary precautions, such as the right to scrutinize the accounts, Nasser tried to blackmail them by playing off the United States against Soviet Russia by circulating stories of Soviet offers to build the project. In the meantime, Nasser was engaged in intensive intrigues against the three Arab dynasties of Iraq, Jordan, and Saudi Arabia, all of whom were linked with the West. To increase their local popular support, these dynasties had to adopt policies more independent of the West, or even anti-Western, in order to avoid the subversive influence of their subjects, of Nasser's wild talk about independence from the West. Most of these anti-Western actions took the form of anti-British actions. One of the chief of these was the dismissal of General Sir John Glubb, so-called Glubb Pasha, who trained and commanded the Jordanian Arab Legion for many years. This dismissal in March 1956 left Jordan in a state of semi-dissolution and in grave danger of being partitioned by its Arab neighbors, Iraq, Egypt, Arabia, since the Arab Legion was one of the chief supports of the dynasty. It also gravely jeopardized British influence in Jordan. To counteract this, the British tried to shift Iraqi troops from Iraq, where the government of Nuri al-Said was still friendly to Britain, to Jordan, where they could be used to support King Hussein and perhaps be used to prevent the anticipated pro-Nasir and anti-British outcome of the Jordan election of October 1956. For the same reason, the British Prime Minister, Sir Anthony Eden, adopted an increasingly anti-Israeli attitude, which culminated late in 1955, when he suggested that the Israeli frontier be redrawn to give some disputed areas to Jordan. Since Israel was already under great threat from both Egypt and Jordan, it continued to rearm in 1956 and made perfectly clear that it would oppose, in any way it could, any union of the Arab states, and especially any move to unite the Iraq and Jordan armed forces or to put them under Egyptian command. In this tense situation, Dulles suddenly upset the balance by withdrawing the United States offer of financial aid for the Aswan Dam. This decision of July 19, 1956, was answered on July 26, fourth anniversary of the expulsion of King Farouk by Nasser, with the sudden nationalization of the Suez Canal Company, so that its profits could be used by Egypt to finance the High Dam. July to October 1956 was a period of mounting crisis in the Near East, as all the principal states concerned mishandled the difficult situation with gross incompetence. There can be no doubt that Egypt had the right to nationalize an Egyptian corporation such as the Suez Canal Company. The only concern of the outside world was the twofold one, that the owners of record be adequately compensated and that the transit operations through the canal be efficiently conducted for all shipping. From the beginning, the British took their stand on other grounds, maintaining incorrectly that the company was not an Egyptian corporation, but an international organization, that the Egyptians could not operate it at all, and that Britain would use force if necessary to prevent Nasser from obtaining control of the canal. France supported Britain, chiefly because it wished to strike at Nasser for his assistance to the anti-French rebels, the FLN, in Algeria. Israel supported these two, while following a completely independent policy, because it was increasingly convinced that its survival as a state depended on its ability to break out of the growing encirclement of the Arab states. Dulles, having precipitated the crisis, sought to placate both sides, refusing to support Britain's arguments, yet unwilling to abandon it in public. Accordingly, as usual, Dulles spent most of his efforts trying to find some verbal formula which would gloss over the differences. Though he refused to support Britain and France for fear this would drive Nasser toward Moscow, he was unable to support the Arab states because he needed France and Britain in the American struggle with the Soviet Union. As a result, his ambivalent and changeable actions and statements alienated both sides. While the controversy raged in public, in secret conferences, and at the United Nations, the canal continued to operate with about a third of the dues, including those of American ships, being paid to the new Egyptian Canal Authority, and the rest going to the old company. The British insisted that the Egyptians were incapable of operating the canal, and to prove the point recalled all British-controlled pilots and technical operators on September 15, 1956, and at the same time challenged the effectiveness of the new administration by presenting a large number of English and French ships for passage. This attempt was based on biased information accepted by Whitehall from the old Suez Company. It proved, in fact, to be wide of the mark, for the remaining Egyptian pilots successfully conducted 50 ships through the canal in one day. Substitute pilots were obtained by very high wages, by advertising throughout the world. The solution of this technical problem left only the second problem: compensation to the former owners. Because Egypt had the funds to make payment, the practical and legal crisis should have been ended. But Britain and France were still determined to force Egypt to accept some type of international control of the canal. And many in both countries were determined to humiliate Nasser and bring about his downfall in order to end his intriguing against the two former imperial powers in the Arab world, especially in the oil-rich Near East and in Algeria. For this reason, the two old allies continued to press for an international canal authority and to prepare their own armed forces in the Near East to compel internationalization. While conferences were still going on in the United Nations and elsewhere, the showdown was precipitated somewhat earlier than London and perhaps Paris had expected by Israel. During the Suez Crisis, the quite separate problem of Israel had become more intense, with increasingly frequent Arab raids on Israel and more violent Israeli reprisals. The situation was made more complex by French support and rearmament for Israel, in the face of continued British support for Jordan and Iraq. Israel felt certain that a complete victory for Nasser in the canal crisis would encourage him to organize a general Arab attack on Israel. Nasser's troublemaking proclivities, even during the canal crisis, were revealed when the French captured an Egyptian ship smuggling 70 tons of arms to the Algerian rebels on October 18th. 2 days before, A secret Anglo-French conference in Paris discussed the situation and probably decided that the two great powers would intervene by an attack on Egypt under the pretext of restoring order if an Arab-Israeli war began. They probably expected this movement sometime in November and were not fully ready when it began on October 29th. The Jordan election of October 21, 1956 was a victory, for the anti-Western, pro-Nasser activist parties pledged to revise the Anglo-Jordan alliance. 2 days later, Egyptian and Syrian military missions arrived in Jordan and at once set up a joint Egyptian-Jordanian-Syrian military command, with an Egyptian designated as commander-in-chief for any future hostilities with Israel. On the same day began the Soviet armed intervention in Hungary to repress the Budapest insurrection. On the following day, Egyptian raiders began to penetrate into Israel, and Israel's mobilization began. 4 days later, on the 29th, Israel attacked Egypt and at once began a spectacular advance across the Sinai Desert toward the Suez Canal and Cairo. The 9-day Israeli Sinai campaign was a brilliant military success. Individual Egyptians and small units often fought fiercely, but the command was incompetent, morale was almost totally absent, and training was equally bad. Whole units fled like sheep, and much of the newly acquired heavy equipment was abandoned, unused. On October 30th, a joint Anglo-French ultimatum was sent to Israel and Egypt, ordering them to stop all warlike action, to withdraw their forces at least 10 miles from the canal, and to permit a temporary occupation of 3 canal points, Port Said, Ismailia, and Suez, by Anglo-French forces. Israel accepted the ultimatum until it was clear that Egypt would not. The latter was attacked by British planes shortly after the ultimatum expired on October 31st, but Allied paratroopers did not drop before November 5th, and the seaborne Anglo-French invasion of Egypt did not begin until November 6th. The United States Department of State was wild with rage at what it regarded as British perfidy and Anglo-Israeli collusion to engage in war outside the Western alliance and collective security system, actions which had always seemed acceptable to Dulles if applied by the United States to the Formosa Strait or other areas of primary American concern. On October 30th, Dulles tried to force through the Security Council of the United Nations a resolution condemning Israel and asking all United Nations members to cut off military, economic, and financial assistance to Israel. This was killed by Anglo-French vetoes, 7-2. Britain, the Commonwealth, and the London Cabinet itself were badly split, while world opinion was strongly against the use of force by any state. In London, 2 ministers resigned, and others threatened to do so. On November 2nd, the Assembly of the United Nations, by its largest majority to date, accepted by a vote of 64-5 a Dulles resolution calling for an immediate ceasefire in the Near East. Egypt and Israel accepted on November 5th, while the Anglo-French forces stopped their advance the following day, 23 miles south of Port Said. The Israeli forces were already across Sinai. Of more permanent significance, the petroleum pipelines and pumping stations bringing oil to Levantine seaports across Syria were destroyed, and a number of block ships sunk by Egypt in the canal had cut off all Near Eastern oil supplies to Western Europe by the direct routes. Most important of all, the parallel American-Soviet threats to France and England and the simultaneous Soviet attack on Hungary had made permanent splits in the two great superpower blocs and had given a greatly increased impetus to the growth of an independent third bloc between them. This development of an increasingly independent buffer fringe between the two disintegrating superpower blocks became the outstanding feature of the next 7 years of world history under the awesome canopy of the Soviet American missile and space race, 1956 to 1963. Liquidation of the Suez Crisis was not completed until the end of 1958, but in the interval, the continued confusions of the whole Near East almost totally concealed the process of liquidation. Much of this confusion arose from inept handling by the Western powers of the very real problems of the area. These problems were four in number. 1. The economic poverty of the area, especially the food crisis in Egypt. 2. The Israel issue. 3. The decline of British power, leading to political instability. And 4. The challenge to the French position in Muslim North Africa, especially in Algeria. The decline in British and French influence was a consequence of World War II, and especially of the decisions of the British and French peoples to devote their wealth and social welfare rather than to efforts to retain their imperial positions. This left a power vacuum. As the Arab states were obviously unable to maintain order in the area or even to govern themselves, and neither the United States nor the Soviet Union was willing to move into the almost insoluble problem of maintaining political stability in the area or to allow the other superpower to make the effort to do so. Britain made feeble efforts to retain its influence in Jordan, Iraq, southern Arabia, and the Persian Gulf. In the case of Jordan and Iraq, at least this was not worth the effort, and was doomed to failure, as became clear with the expulsion of Glub Pasha in March 1956, and the overthrow of the Iraqi monarchy, and of Nuri al-Said in July 1958. American policy in the Near East was based on a series of assumptions, which were so remote from the truth that no successful policy could be based on them. These were: 1. The Near East was an area in which the Soviet Union had plans for immediate penetration and subversion in order to communize it. 2. That the Arab world was a unified bloc with significant intrinsic power of its own, which would join the Soviet bloc, or at least contribute to increase its strength, if not constantly placated by concessions. 3. That no policy of neutralism of the Near East was feasible or acceptable to the West. 4. That the public opinion of the masses of Arab peoples was of some significance to the formulation of policy in the Arab states. And 5. That the arming of the Arab states would contribute to their ability to resist Soviet penetration and to the political stability of the area. All five of these assumptions were untrue. The Soviet Union had no significant plans to communize, to subvert, or to penetrate the Near East after 1948, and was eager to see it become a stable and neutral area in order to deprive the United States of any excuse to intervene there. Moreover, the Arab states were neither united nor strong, but were diverse, filled with mutual hatreds and petty jealousies, and almost totally incapable of acting as a bloc, even when their primary interests were threatened. In fact, their only common interests were hatred of Israel, desire to be independent and neutral, and the desire for economic handouts, without any accompanying political commitments, from anyone who would give them. The public opinion of the Arab peoples described in the previous sentence was of little influence in the face of the concentration of local political power in the hands of the local armed forces, which were, with perhaps exception of Nasser himself, corruptible, Efforts to arm these forces against a non-existent Soviet armed threat contributed nothing to their ability to defend the area itself, and merely increased their corruption, their economic burden on the people, and the political instability of the area by increasing their abilities to threaten each other or Israel. Dulles's policies in the Near East were consistently the opposite of what they should have been. No possible alliance or rearming of the Arab states could have contributed anything to the area's ability to resist communism, nor could the Arab states have contributed anything but headaches to the Kremlin if Washington's policies had driven them into the arms of Russia. Overall defense of the area should have been based on Ethiopia, Israel, and Turkey. The Arab states should have been given the independence, neutrality, and economic aid they wanted. The latter should have concentrated on the Aswan Dam and a Jordan Valley Authority, similar to TVA, for the mutual benefit of Jordan, Israel, and Syria. In return for the Arab states' acceptance of 1. A peace treaty with Israel, and 2. Resettlement of the Arab refugees from the Israeli war on the new agricultural lands provided by the Jordan Valley Project. And finally, the United States should have declared unilaterally that it would use any force necessary to prevent any Soviet intrusion into the Near East or any attack on the independence of Israel. As a supplementary, but probably unachievable project, the United States should have sought a pooling of the enormous oil revenues of the whole Near East to provide funds for the economic reconstruction of the area as a whole within the framework of an Arab economic community based on free trade and free immigration within the Arab world. Instead of some progressive solution of the Near East problem and the Suez crisis, the United States, acting through the United Nations, sought to restore the basically precarious status quo ante bellum without any guarantees. The real difficulty was Israel, which refused for several months to yield up the areas it had occupied without obtaining, in return, some solution of its grievances. These grievances were, 1. The refusal of the Arab states to make a peace treaty or to accept the existence of Israel by ending the 1948 war. 2. The Arab economic, social, and political blockade of Israel, which included boycotts of all world business firms which did business with Israel. 3. The denial of the Suez Canal to Israeli ships or identifiable Israeli goods since 1948. 4. Constant harassment of Israeli shipping or fishing on the Gulf of Aqaba and the Jordan River. And 5. The use of the Gaza Strip, non-Egyptian territory occupied by Egypt under the 1948 armistice, as a basis for guerrilla raids on Israel. Eventually, American pressure and world public opinion, acting through the United Nations, forced Israel to give up the territory it had captured, including the Gaza Strip and the Gulf of Aqaba shores, without any significant guarantees. A UN emergency force, UNEF, was sent to supervise the evacuation of Egyptian territory and the Gaza Strip. Under pressure of severe economic and financial threats of an unofficial nature from Washington, the effectiveness of such threats rested on the fact that the whole Israeli economy was dependent on the flow of private funds from the United States, while the British attack on Egypt had been abandoned very largely as a consequence of the drain on British dollar and gold reserves, which fell $420 million in September through November 1956. The American threats of sanctions against its own friends and allies over Egypt at the very time when it was doing nothing to impose sanctions for the Soviet attack on Hungary and its refusal to cooperate with the Soviet Union in stabilizing the Near East because of Hungary, presented a strategic picture of political fantasy as 1956 ended. One of the methods of pressure used by the United States against the Western powers was support of Egypt's refusal to allow any clearance of the Suez Canal until the withdrawal of troops from Egypt. This, of course, intensified the shortage of Near Eastern fuel oil in Europe as winter deepened. The evacuation of Anglo-French forces on December 22, 1956, and of Israeli forces on March 8, 1957, permitted clearing of the canal and the reimposition of Egyptian blockade pressure on Israel. In the interval, the American position, ignoring all the real problems of the area, was stated in the form of the so-called Eisenhower Doctrine in January 1957. Regarding the problem, solely in terms of military opposition to communism, this doctrine attacked the Soviet Union and threatened to use the armed forces of the United States to defend any freedom-loving nations of the area, requesting such aid against overt armed aggression from any nation controlled by international communism. In reply to this unconstructive promise, the Soviet Union, in February 1957, suggested a joint effort by four powers, Russia, the United States, Britain, and France, to reorganize the Near East on the basis of six principles. 1. Peaceful settlement of all disputes there. 2. Non-interference in internal affairs. 3. Renunciation of all efforts to incorporate Near Eastern countries into military blocs of the great powers. 4. Removal of foreign military bases from the area and the troops based on them. 5. A reciprocal ban on arms deliveries. And 6. Promotion of economic development without political or military entanglements. This promising Soviet offer, which might have been negotiated into some settlement of the Near East's real problems, was rebuffed by the United States. Instead, the Eisenhower Doctrine, in spite of the clear lack of any overt communist threat, was used against Egypt and Syria in regard to Jordan and Lebanon. The Jordan monarchy was completely dependent upon the army, which was, in turn, completely dependent upon the financial subsidy from Britain. This subsidy, amounting to $12 million a year, was ended by the new parliament elected in October 1956. Syria and Saudi Arabia, which already had troops on Jordanian soil, joined with Egypt to continue the subsidy. To escape from growing Egyptian and Soviet influence, King Hussein dismissed his prime minister and sought aid from Washington. Rioting from opposition groups led to martial law. A $10 million grant under the Eisenhower Doctrine and movement of the American Sixth Fleet to the Levant to support Hussein, April 1957. The rivalry between Saudi Arabia and Egypt for influence in the other Arab countries was marked by an Egypt-Syria economic union in September 1957, a $112 million loan to Syria from the Soviet bloc, and in February 1958, the union of these two countries into a United Arab Republic. Iraq and Jordan responded to this with a very ephemeral Arab federation. By the spring of 1958, Nasser was engaged in controversies with all his neighboring states except Syria. A military coup by pro-Nasser officers in Iraq in July abolished the monarchy and assassinated Nouri al-Said and his chief supporters and threatened to overthrow the insecure government of President Chermon of Lebanon. To prevent this, American forces were landed in Lebanon in the same week, July 15th through the 17th, in which a United Nations commission on the spot reported a total lack of evidence of any outside forces trying to subvert Lebanon. On the following day, Hussein of Jordan asked and obtained a British parachute brigade to protect his position. Once again, Khrushchev appealed for a great Power Conference, this time to include India, on the Near East, but was met by a series of evasions and legalistic obstacles from Washington. The United States refused to act outside the United Nations, and the suggestion finally ended in a series of recriminatory letters in August. A special session of the United Nations Assembly sent General Dag Hammarskjöld on a mission to the Near East, which was able to evacuate the troops from Lebanon and Jordan by November 1958. This turmoil in the Muslim states continued during the subsequent period of Soviet-American missile rivalry, 1956 to 1963. The United Arab Republic of Egypt and Syria, established in February 1958, was broken by Syria after a military coup had overturned the Syrian government in September 1961. Another Syrian military revolt, early in 1963, announced its reestablishment. But internal opposition, chiefly from the Ba'ath Party, prevented this. In Iraq, of July 1958, led by General Abdul Karim Qasim, remained in power on a relatively pro-communist and anti-Nasir basis until it was overthrown in a bloody military upheaval on February 8th through the 9th, 1963.